Right now at 10, it's election night. We have live team coverage of the results and how they'll impact you.
From the closely watched and controversial ballot question on the future of the Minneapolis Police Department to the mayors in St. Paul and Minneapolis and rent control measures.
Plus, expert analysis, and we see today's election through your eyes.
In weather, we'll wake up to another morning with temperatures in the 20s, a hard freeze. But it just takes a few more days before we start to rebound.
And with the CDC giving the green light to get younger kids vaccinated for COVID, how soon the rollout could start in Minnesota. It's Tuesday, Election Day, November 2nd. KARE 11 News at 10 starts now. Thanks for joining us tonight. It is election night in the Twin Cities, and for the last few hours, we have been watching the results roll in for some very important races.
And we can now report the effort to replace the Minneapolis Police Department has failed. We'll have much more on that as part of our live team coverage tonight. We'll also have updates on other big races. The mayors of both Minneapolis and St. Paul are hoping to keep their jobs. Results are coming in on that. And for other ballot questions that will impact you. Plus, we have political analysis of all the big moments.
Well, with nearly all precincts reporting, again, the effort to replace the Minneapolis Police Department has been rejected by voters. Here's a look at the numbers. No took more than 56% of the vote. We want to head to Lauren Lemanchek live right now for a reaction from those who fought hard to keep the police department intact. Lauren?
Well, Julie, certainly this was a question that was watched across the nation, but those who fought against this ballot question say tonight's vote really shows what was happening on the streets of Minneapolis, particularly in those neighborhoods who have been hardest hit by crime. Now, even though they had some of the biggest names in the city, Mayor Fry, Chief Arredondo, who came out strongly against the ballot question, people who organized against it really weren't quite sure how tonight would go. They were actually, some of them, surprised by how wide of a margin the question was defeated. I spoke with Don Samuels, a key organizer against the effort, who even sued the city of Minneapolis over the ballot question. Here's what he had to say about the results.
It also says that Minneapolis is a compassionate city. And it understands that the folks who experience crime and violence the greatest are deserving support. And so it's just a wonderful thing to see the people of Minneapolis come together to create a sensible future. We need to get together now and really put pressure on the system so that it will be more responsive to us, that we will hire, train, support, discipline, and fire police officers with high standards.
So you heard that looking toward the future, those who oppose this ballot question, many of them say they aren't satisfied with the status quo. They still want to see a lot of police reform, but they want to do it within the current system. Now, of course, police agencies were strongly against the measure. We have not heard from the Minneapolis Police Union tonight, but we did just get a statement from the statewide Minnesota Police and Peace Officers Association saying this should be a wake-up call to politicians who want to defund and abolish police department. So you can see how they are looking at this on the broader spectrum of politics across the state and the country. Julie and Randy.
All right, Lauren, thank you. Let's head to Lou Burgos. He's in Minneapolis with the Yes for Minneapolis group, the group that got this question on the ballot and pushed to get it passed. Lou.
Well, Randy, the music is playing loud here downtown. No, but this is really the party that never materialized because the results were already not looking good for the vote yes folks as they were pouring in tonight. As the organizers began to speak, they alluded to what are maybe some silver linings for their movement. They literally made hundreds of thousands of door knocks and had thousands and thousands of conversations with people about public safety and about policing. And they turned a lot of people to their side, and they believe opened up a lot of eyes on the subject as well. Let's listen in to what one of them had to say on the topic.
What we did is we invited people in to talk about exactly what the definition of public safety was for them. What did they want to see change? How did they pain and they frustration become political and politicized by us? So when we invited people in, these are the very same people now who drove the work.
And so now the question is, where do they go from here? And one of those organizers alluded to what could be the next strategy. We don't know how they're going to do it yet, but one of them said they want to challenge the police federation, the union, that a lot of people that want police reform believe that the union stands in the way of reform by not allowing bad cops to be fired for wrongdoing and so forth. And so I guess that's something that we'll watch in the weeks and months to come. Back to you.
All right, Lou, thank you. Well, now to the Minneapolis mayoral race. Incumbent Democrat Jacob Frey has not yet secured the needed votes to win yet. Here's a look at where the first choice rankings stand right now. We may have to wait until tomorrow now for final results. Let's go live to Danny Spiewak from Mayor Frey's election night party in St. Anthony, Maine. Danny?
Well, Mayor Frey came out here and addressed the crowd just a couple of minutes ago, and although he said he's going to let the ranked choice voting process play out, he seemed to be in a celebratory mood and told the crowd that, quote, we are winning right now and we are winning big. Right now, Jacob Frey has about 43% of the first round votes. That's compared to some of his main challengers, Sheila Nejad, as well as Kate Knuth, are in that 18 to 20 range. For perspective, Mayor Frey had 25% of the first round votes in 2017 and then ended up winning after six tabulations. So his campaign here appears very confident that he's going to eventually win when all of this tabulation is done tomorrow. But he didn't officially say that. He stopped short of declaring victory, just seemed to be very confident. Now, with question two going down, which of course the mayor had opposed, the mayor also with that was quite celebratory. There was a lot of cheering, and although he didn't specifically mention question two, he never said the words question two, it was implied with this crowd. And earlier the mayor talked about reform efforts. He said that this isn't a blow to reform. He said in his opinion that question two losing isn't a blow to reform, that he says he's the candidate and the mayor that will lead Minneapolis into future reforms. Take a listen.
Reform has begun, but it must continue. With the necessary, with understanding the magnitude of this particular moment and making sure that we're all, each and every one of us, rallying around the cause of change. These solutions, the change that we want to see, it is complex. And so it's going to require each and every one of us to understand the complexity of the situations to get to true change.
So I just want to repeat myself so that it's crystal clear. With almost all of the precincts reporting, Mayor Jacob Frey is in the lead by a fairly large margin, and his campaign believes that it will be enough, or at least has implied that. However, he has stopped short of saying that. He's going to let the ranked choice voting play out tomorrow. And again, we're not going to get those results tonight, so there will not be a winner declared. We're going to have to check back in tomorrow. But there's a lot of cheering here at his watch party here at St. Anthony, Maine, right on the riverfront. Back to you.
All right. Thank you, Danny. And there has been a lot of talk as well about the Minneapolis City Council. Every single, all 13 seats were up. And here are the results from some of those closely watched races. Latricia Vita took 61% of the vote in Ward 4, unseating incumbent, Philippe Cunningham. And in Ward 11, Emily Koski took 58% of the vote, beating incumbent Jeremy Schrader. We are also seeing that Andrea Jenkins, the incumbent, and Linnea Palmisano will both keep their city council seats. We have political reporter John Croman with us tonight for some insight. John, the big question is, how does this move the city council, if at all, more progressive or more centrist Democrat?
I would say it's more centrist, if you end up going to break it down that way. It's clear that in the city council races, a lot of these became a referendum on public safety, more specifically on ballot question two. Andrea Jenkins, of course, she, despite standing on that stage in Powderhorn Park days after George Floyd's death, she also has been out front in trying to reopen George Floyd Square. Philippe Cunningham, the others you mentioned, again, they were going probably up against a backlash against the council for moving too far to the left since 2017. The word common sense was used in a lot of the campaign lit by those who were challenging council members, especially the council members who favor dismantling the MPD. Of course, Ward 5, Jeremiah Ellison leads, but still has two competitors nipping at his heels. So that's going to go to ranked choice tabulation tomorrow. And interestingly, in Ward 1, Elliot Payne, who campaigned on police reform, leads the incumbent Kevin Reich there. So not totally a referendum on public safety, but for the most part, kind of a pushback against the council going too far, too fast in the last 4 years.
All right. Thanks, John.
Well, now to the results of two other ballot questions in Minneapolis. Question one would increase the power of the mayor, eliminating an executive committee that has decision-making powers. Right now, yes, a strong mayor system is leading. Question three opens the door to rent control in Minneapolis, giving the city council the authority to regulate rents at some point in the future, either by direct action or submitting it to voters. Right now, the yes votes are also leading, but it's closer.
Well, the results have really been trickling in St. Paul for the mayoral race and the rent control ballot questions. As of right now, we only have 1% of precincts reporting. Mayor Carter is leading with the ballot question yes is leading. Of course, that's just 1% of the precincts reporting. Charmaine Nero is live at Allianz Field in St. Paul with how they're doing there. Hi, Charmaine.
Hi, Julie. Yes, Mayor Melvin Carter should be walking in any minute right now. He was supposed to arrive about 30 minutes ago, but he's coming a little later. But we do know right now that he is leading in the votes. As far as that rent control measure, it's still a very close race. We know that a yes vote on that ballot question one would cap rent hikes at 3% per year. But this year, Mayor Melvin Carter faced seven challengers, including a St. Paul firefighter and community advocates. Now, they all faced a lot of questions about public safety in light of recent crime and in light of last year's unrest. So we're going to stay out here and get ready for Mayor Melvin Carter to come out, but we'll provide more updates in just a bit. Back to you.
All right. Thanks so much, Charmaine. Coming up here at 10, some other headlines of the day. When doses of the COVID vaccine for younger kids will be arriving in Minnesota after today's approval from the CDC.
Plus, take care of your money tonight goes crypto. Digital currency is catching on, but could you get through an entire day just paying with Bitcoin? We try it next. But first, here's Belle.
Well, we're heading.